Welcome back to Living for God's Word, where the plan is to read the Bible in 52 weeks using Dr. Kimberly D. Moore's book, The Bible in 52 Weeks, a year-long Bible study for women. We are in week 32, and the title is, Oh, What Love. And before we dive in, let us go to the throne of grace. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your love. We thank you, Lord, for your mercy. We thank you, Lord, for waking us up this morning and giving us your son, Jesus. We just love you, oh God. And as we delve into your word, Lord God, may we glean from it what you intend for us to glean. And may we go out and be ambassadors of your son, Jesus. Amen. Thank you for tuning in. And if this is your first time tuning in, feel free to go back to the introductory video on this channel that describes the 52-week plan. It has to, in all of the videos, each week's reviews and the description has the resources as well as the plan. And so I just pray for you. You continue to pray for me as we slay this giant of reading the Bible in 52 weeks in the name of Jesus. And so Dr. Moore, in her book, and also in the description, and we talk about the resources. I use the Women's Study Bible in the New King James Version, and whatever version that you have, even if this is your first time coming across the screen, you don't own a Bible, pick up whatever version you like. Dr. Moore happens to use the New King James Version and the New Living Translation, and she also references other translations throughout the book. So God's Word is always good. So whatever translation works for you, He is just pleased. And so we started the Song of Solomon. And what I've been doing in the other videos is, for whenever we begin a book, I will go into my Bible's introduction, which has the of each chapter, and for all of them, I'm going to read for Song of Solomon the title, the author, the date, the background. This gives context. And so the title of Song in my Bible, the Hebrew title, Shir Hashirim, literary Song of Songs, is an expression of the superlative meaning the best song. The Latin name is Canticles, songs. The Hebrew Bible places the song in the Megaloth, the scrolls, a collection of books read on feast days of the Jews. Ruth, Esther, Ecclesiastes, and Lamentations are also included in this book, in this group, excuse me. The author is King Solomon, the son of David and Bathsheba, claims authorship of the book, and that's referenced in Psalm 1:1. The wisest man on his day, he authored 1,005 songs, and that's referencing, see, 1 Kings 4:32. The song is consonant with his great wisdom and skill. Solomon's name appears repeatedly in the book, in Psalm 1:1, 5, 3, and 7, 9, 11, 8, 11, and 12. And the events occur in a royal setting. Also, the book's geographic reference seems to assume a united kingdom. See the map. Locations in the song. The date. The song was written during Solomon's 40-year reign, 971 through 931 BC, probably during the earliest years of his reign. Background setting. Solomon presided over the royal court in Jerusalem. However, many geographical locations throughout the kingdom are mentioned. And it does say, see the map, locations in the song. Solomon's authorship has been questioned, though not until the 19th century. And arguments suggest against Solomonic authorship have been inconclusive. Most evangelical scholars remain in support of Solomonic authorship, the purpose of Song of Solomon. The song is an epithalamium or nuptial song, an expression of love between a bride and her bridegroom. Biblical scholars have debated whether the song should be read figuratively or literally. Many Jewish and Christian scholars have interpreted this poetic expression of human physical love as a historical relationship that could also be interpreted as a divine parable. So I won't finish the background, but I will skip over to, because this is very good. It's very good. This is commentary. It's always very good. I'm going to skip down to Oh, the last paragraph of the background, it says, no other Old Testament book is so full of technical terms for spices. Okay, well, that's good to know. That is good to know. But I will skip down to the theme. The song stresses the themes of love and devotion between a man and a woman committed to one another, while also echoing the loving relationship between Yahweh and his people Israel, and between Christ and his church. With aesthetic imagery, Solomon skillfully highlighted the splendor and majesty of God. No traces of the polytheism that appears in other poetry of this time period is found in the song. For women, the song pictures a bride who is healthy, balanced, and truly loved. In contrast to many contemporary writers who depict female weakness or victimization as inevitable and absolute, God presents a portrait of wholeness and hope, a reflection of the intimate relationship between the man and woman in the Garden of Eden can be traced as mutual devotion and respect between a husband and wife develop as they are related harmoniously with the natural world around them. Amen. So that's the background. So Dr. Moore's week 32, it's on page 110. We were in the Song of Solomon, Song of Songs, in my Bible's Song of Solomon, but it's we were in chapters 1 through 8. And so Dr. Moore focuses on 1 through 8. And so we also read Psalms 107 through 128. So this is a Bible reading plan for the entire 52 weeks. So continue to read. But Dr. Moore's commentary, you know, she chooses certain books and chapters to focus on. So the title again is Oh What Love. And so the commentary basically is a love story. I mean, the commentary basically says that this is a love story. And so, which we know that the Bible is a love story. So God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, so that everyone who believed in him would have everlasting life. Amen. And so would not die and have everlasting life. Okay, so I'm going to read the commentary. I love this. Okay, the Song of Songs is a collection of love poems told from the perspective of two individuals who are desperately in love with one another. Their desire for each other is obvious in their descriptions, which are so specific you can sense the sexual tension between them. And so we are going to, and on page 110, it's like I mentioned, it's 1 through 8. And so this particular commentary is, we're going to focus on chapter 4, verses 3 through 5, and then chapter 8, verses 6 and 7. Okay, so I'll continue with the commentary. The man says to his beloved, your lips are like scarlet ribbon. Your mouth is inviting. Your cheeks are like rosy pomegranates behind your veil. Your breasts, now this is continuing. Your breasts are like two fawns, twin fawns of a gazelle grazing among the lilies. That's Song of Songs 4, 3 through 5. But he confirms that this love, this is a commentary, but he confirms that this love goes beyond physical attraction. Amen. So then we're going to go down to chapter 8, verses 6 and 7. For love is as strong as death. Its jealousy as enduring as the grave. Love flashes like fire, the brightest kind of flame. Many waters cannot quench love, nor can rivers drown it. If a man tried to buy love with all his wealth, his offer would be utterly scorned. Amen. That's a word of God. Love is dangerous, and this is a commentary, and life-giving at the same time. Now, we are studying the Bible, but we also watch movies, right? You know that there's a movie called There's a Thin Line Between Love and Hate. But we're talking about God's love. God will continue that it can be dangerous, right? And it can be life-giving at the same time. Love hurts, but it also restores. These poems reveal just how complicated and yet satisfying love is. And at the end of the day, love is a gift from God. And God is complex. He's loving, he's satisfying, and he's so much more. Many say that these writings are actually allegorical and that the romance is symbolic of the love God demonstrated for his children. Like I said, God so loved the world, John 3:16. It shows how he loved, that was my insertion. It shows how he loved us so passionately that he gave a portion of himself when he sent his son to die on the cross. How interesting that the metaphor used to express that is a beautiful love story. Who doesn't like a good love story? Amen, a good love story. If you're like me, ladies, Dr. Moore is saying it, me too, you cherish the thought of someone loving you completely and unconditionally. And she says men do too, they do. Most women I know, and me too, would love their significant others to pay such close attention to them, describing their appearance with such passion, flowery words. The Song of Songs causes one to long for that kind of love. Well, believe it or not, that's how God loves us. He loves us. He loves us so passionately and completely that he sacrificed his only son for our sins. Hallelujah, Jesus. And we know, we have been reading the Old Testament. We know the story. We know that God chose a people, and thank God we've been adopted into those who have confessed Jesus Christ. We have been adopted into that family. But God had to choose, well, I'm not saying what God had to do, God do what he wanted to do, but he chose a people as a demonstration, or as an example, right, for the world. And so we saw how he loved them, how he gave them chance after chance, and gave them instructions how to worship him, how to love him. And like we do today, we don't always listen, but he still loves us. And that's the thing, he still loves us. Thank God. Yes, he sacrificed his only son. Many of us denied him and even ran from him. Amen. But he loved us so much that he chased after us and proved his love. Amen. So if there's ever a time when you're feeling devoid of love, think about the Song of Songs and God's amazing love. Oh, what love. Amen. So the points to ponder this week, and every week Dr. Moore has at least 3 points to ponder. And sometimes she has an action for the week, and I'm on page 112 of the book. So points to ponder, number one, I said that I would come back and share my points to ponder as you individually, since this is a individual reading plan, that you would get the book and then that you would go through it on your own. But I'm sharing. So the first question is, if you had to describe your love for God, how would you describe it? In reading the commentary, when Dr. Moore says chasing after us, I thought about Cece Winans' song on her album Believe For It. She has a song called The Goodness of God, and it's just a beautiful song. And in a part of the song, she says, your goodness is running after, it's running after me. Your goodness is running after, it's running after me. With my life laid down, I surrender now. I give you everything. Oh yes, your goodness is running after, it's running after me. So God is, yeah, he's amazing. So his mercy, and that's another part of her song. For his mercy never fails me. Yes, so that's how I would describe it. His mercy, his goodness and his mercy never fail. No matter how we fall down, we get back up. And that's another song. But his mercy never fails. Amen. So, number two, if you had to convince someone else of God's love for them, how would you share his love? John 3:16. God to love the world, that he gave his only begotten son, so that those who believe in him shall not perish, meaning they shall not die, but they shall have everlasting life. So we die, yes we do, but we are not dead forever. In Christ we rise again. Hallelujah. The resurrection is a symbol of dying and rising again. So hallelujah. And he rose. We know this. The word tells us that he rose. He died and he rose on the third day. Hallelujah. On that Sunday morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. Whew. Okay, number three. How has God shown his love toward you in this past week? He has reminded me that he's the one in control and that he loves me. And so the actions that Dr. Moore had for this past week was, she said, take a moment and really think about your love relationship with the Lord. Then take some time and write your love story. How did you meet? How did you meet God? What were the circumstances surrounding your first encounter? When did you really decide to come into a covenant relationship with him? How do you intend to prove your continued love to him? Yes, because God is looking for us to be ambassadors to him. And the Great Commission is, and go ye therefore into the world and make disciples of all nations. And he told his disciples that before he ascended, into heaven after he walked the earth, after he rose and he walked the earth, before he ascended back into heaven. He said, I'll be back again, but I need for you, to continue this work. And so he's just an awesome God. That's what the Bible teaches us. He's just an awesome God. So I pray that you have been blessed and that you will continue on this journey of the 52-week Bible reading plan. And this coming week, starting tomorrow, it would be week 33. And it's titled, I'm Not Worthy, But I'll Go. And we will start in Isaiah. Isaiah 1 through 4 is day 1. Day 2 is Isaiah 5 through 8. Day 3 is Isaiah 9 through 12. Day 4 is Isaiah 13 through 16. Day 5 is Isaiah 17 through 20. Day 6 is Isaiah 21 through 24. And day 7 is a day to catch up on any readings that you may have missed. And that I said that I will come back and share my points to ponder as you work on your points to ponder. Thank you, Lord. Continue to pray for me while I pray for you. Amen.